So we look now at Extract from Out of the Blue. If you haven't seen the YouTube version of this with this is from Simon Amity's poem, I thoroughly suggest you do. I think this section is on the third video. You just put an Extract from Out of the Blue and look for the third or four. It's awesome. Very, very haunting. So we look here, and I think just reading that, you really kind of set you up before you actually try and look at this. So first of all, in the structure, we've got a monologue, and that's really good because it allows us to get the thoughts, you know, the exact thoughts of actually what's going on. And obviously, this is really about personal perspective, so that's really important. Obviously, it's put to us in a monologue. The structure in the title, Out of the Blue, that's really interesting. It's got three meanings. Obviously, the idea is the strike was out of the blue in terms of you weren't expecting it. Obviously, the phrase out of the blue, obviously, to do with that surprise, but that's not just a surprise of the attack, that's obviously a surprise of the person living their day, you know, obviously, what happened. And obviously, out of the blue just means obviously something coming out of the sky. So, you've got three ways to actually extract different ideas from there. The other structure point I actually want to mention is the questions. So we have a question here, and we have a longer question here, and we have a question just down here as well. And all of them are referencing the reader in the second person, or basically it could be obviously us as a reader, but also it's the person, maybe a person that he was highlighting on, this person in the building in one of the towers actually highlighting when he actually looked out the window and saw. So anyway, the questions kind of give us a real world there in ourselves, you know, asking us, you know, how much have we thought of the victims, but also in terms of, you know, on the day when he was looking down, you know, if you can imagine those people looking down, you know, they would have been looking, thinking, you know, who there can help them from anyone that they saw. Meaning then, well, obviously one of the things is about personal perspectives, obviously thinking about 9/11 and thinking about other atrocities that happen where people are obviously, you know, really sad casualties, and we actually look at, you know, try and think about how they would have been. Obviously the recent incident last year in Norway springs to mind as well, you know, just about how, you know, reading about personal perspectives of people who survived, and obviously just, you know, it's just unbelievable. And so really looking at perspectives in atrocities is a really strong theme here, and obviously the feelings and obviously the ideas that someone goes through to an extent, obviously, because we don't have that many survivors' tales, I don't believe, from this particular atrocity. The idea as well of things being hard to fathom, you know, just, you know, are we really seeing what we're seeing? And obviously in a lot of the images you see from the day, you know, you get that feeling, but here obviously you get the idea. He's like, you know, does anyone see the soul worth saving? You know, you've noticed that, you know, there's this cotton shirt twirling. And then he actually says, you know, do you think it's just a man shaking crumbs out of his shirt or hanging out washing? It's just the idea of, you know, seeing that. And obviously for so many people, just the idea of what happened is just unbelievable, just to think that that could come out of, you know, just on a normal day. And obviously we've got the idea coming through of the human courage. You know, he's trying here to actually stay alive, and he's trying to actually get people's attention here by the fact that he's waving, etc., and everything around him is you know, really, really, obviously it's a terrible situation. And he says, you know, I'm not the point of launching and leaving, I'm not trying to surrender. And obviously the surrender that he's talking about is his life, you know, he's not trying to give up, etc., etc. And obviously he tries to, you know, get people's attention and, you know, get to the window and save himself as best he can, but then obviously it doesn't work that way. But then obviously in ourselves, you know, afterwards we know about the rescue attempts, and, you know, some people were saved in the rubble, etc., etc. Yeah, it just shows the human courage of what, you know, what people would actually do, and how they would go about trying to how they were trying to go about saving themselves and saving others. So the images that we have, well, we got the image of the shirt, obviously the most powerful one, especially when you remember, if you remember it from the videos, or if you watch the video with the poem. The idea of the shirt there, we've got this, the white cotton shirt, you know, this person, the idea of white here, maybe this person's, you know, completely innocent of any crime to, excuse me, you know, innocent of any crime of execution, you know, why is he there? The idea of the actual shirt, you know, just, we all remember the image again. It's really actually interesting to actually try and talk about something that we have such an amazing array of cultural references for, because in that sense, because obviously the images are imprinted on us, so when we read this, we know exactly what it's talking about. We don't actually need to imagine it. So normally when images are presented to us, you know, we're getting scenes presented to try and help us think about all of this. But you know, that shirt coming out there, you know, we're watching it twirl, and obviously the man falling, you know, two of the most striking images from the day, among hundreds. It's really just really kind of gives us the idea of, you know, just so many things. We've got the image of the height and obviously the danger that the person's in. So the danger that they're in, obviously you've got the heat and it's searing, and we've also got the depth when he's actually looking down from where he is in the building, you know, and it's appalling. It's just shocking, you know, it probably makes him feel sick along with everything else that's going on. We've got obviously the heat. Sorry, I just mentioned that there, the heat, obviously, and then obviously the smoke that comes from it, because obviously the inhalation there is obviously making him more and more tired, which is one of the other images that we get, you know, the idea of them being weak and ultimately helpless, you know, because we've got the sirens below me wailing, and you know, there's all this kind of hubbub down below, you know, lots going on, but nothing actually coming to him, you know, he can't actually do anything, and he's trapped. I think this is really interesting here, the reference here. You know, is this is this a reference now? Was this whole thing a reference to the reader, or was it a reference to a loved one that he's actually thinking about? And was it a loved one that he was actually trying to kind of hold himself together? Sorry, I should have put that up in meanings, and I'll add it now. So I just put thoughts of a loved one. That's obviously something that you can read into. And if you look at it that way, does that happen? Obviously here, you know, it's like, does anyone see a soul worth saving? So it's more directly at the reader and the people below. But in that one, do you see my love? You know, that could that be just in terms of, you know, someone specific he was actually thinking about? And obviously with the "your" there, you know, it's a specific person. So again, you've got this ambiguity of exactly who's it to. And you could look at it that way. So it's thoughts to a loved one on times like that is another one of the meanings. So the language then, we've got a lot of repetition all the way through, you know, which really kind of just strikes how shocked the person is and disorientated they are, and obviously as they're talking about this. So we've got the waving, and we've got believing, and tiring, and it's just again like shocking both, you know, the waving is just continuous, he's just doing everything he can to get attention. The believing again is just talking about the people's shock and how they actually feel about it, and the tiring is how obviously his body's actually giving up because of the smoke inhalation and whatever else. So it's you know, really powerful all the way through. You've got alliteration right here at the beginning, you know, which just kind of gives the movement of the shirt like a really, it really just brings home, sorry, to the movement of the shirt, you know, that it's twirling and turning, and it's, you know, kind of doing both. And obviously twirl is probably supposed to be more fancy, but a turning is just kind of like a more monotonous thing. So maybe he was doing it in a certain rhythm at first, and then, you know, at the end of the day, as it goes through, his wrist just becomes more and more tired, and it's more of a turn than a twirl. Perhaps you could read that way. We've also got I think this is just a brilliant word, the use of the word gills when it's actually talking about the here in the gills I'm still breathing, because it's actually a direct reference to the building, obviously the way it is shaped with the columns, obviously some of them protruding, well, it's not columns, sorry, the fascia on the outside of the building, you know, one of them was sticking out more if you look at the actual building, you know, and then it's like an indent and then out and then indent and then out, and so it kind of looks like, you know, like kind of the lines across a fish's gills, and obviously because there's smoke coming out of there, you know, the idea of them working like gills is actually really, really important, because that idea of the thing breathing in some way, but obviously it breathing with the smoke, because obviously this man can't breathe. So obviously there's a link there to life, and the link there to, you know, just the ebb that he's going through, obviously, you know, because he can't breathe in that situation, much the same as we can't breathe in water, and obviously suddenly turn the building into this thing that like a fish's gills, you know, that we can't breathe in, is, I think, it's a genius way of actually characterizing that, because obviously the man can't breathe, and that's why he's starting to flag and tire. Also we've got the second person reference, which I've touched on briefly with the idea of a loved one just towards the end, but obviously the second person reference, you know, right from the beginning, you've picked me out, isn't that like, you can see me, you know, what are you going to do, how are you going to get me, and you know, when will you come, you know, how are you going to rescue me, etc., you know, putting us right there, and then do you think, so all of these are kind of really putting us in there, really trying to make us understand, you know, what it is we think we're seeing, and you know, what is actually happening, sorry. And you know, again, it just gets us thinking about the well, it just gets us thinking about the, you know, just again, the shock of the day-to-day life. You know, it's like, do you think you're watching? It's like, you know, how could I be watching someone who possibly could be about to jump to his death? You know, whenever I personally see one of those videos, it's just unbelievable. In fact, there's a great documentary about the day. I think it was done by the Discovery Channel, the History Channel, and it was just like a kind of a catalog, a timeline catalog of the day, and it just shows you all the most powerful images of the day. It was unbelievable. You know, like there's probably about 10 times while I was watching it, it just was just, you know, an absolute shock. And yeah, you just remembering it all is unbelievable. You know what we did anyway. So yeah, the second person reference now. Yeah, and obviously at the end we've got the, I think there's one more time we've got another reference. Forgive me, it's not, yeah, forgive me, it doesn't actually come to me right now. Yeah, so the effect on the reader, then we've got the remembering of the victims and the ordeal. Obviously, that's the first thing that actually makes us do and obviously think about what it must have been like at the moment of the building. So many people who still can't watch stuff and obviously think about this. It's really, really, you know, it's really, you know, it's well, let's hope it's just a once in a lifetime thing, you know. But obviously, what happened in Norway, you know, we've still got atrocities happening. And then obviously, the shock, you know, just to remind us of how shocking this was, and obviously, people's feelings, and obviously, you know, the attempts and the life that people were actually going through. And then I know this is probably not the most you know, not the most kind of sensitive thing to say, but just reminds you of the change, you know, how your life can change in a second. You know, anything can happen. And although I've seen this extent, obviously this person's life has changed, obviously they're going to die, and so many, you know, millions of people were affected by what happened that day. But it just reminds you know, just out of the blue, you know, something can just happen. And obviously, say, like anyone who's involved in a car crash or an accident, or you know, involved in anything, you know, just you know, you know, so many small things can happen. Just like if you know, just something that happens. Sorry, I just think of so many things in my head, but they don't compare in any way to this, so I don't really want to mention them. But just that idea of, you know, just change being able to come. Obviously, this poem might get you thinking about that as well. Yeah, great poem. And again, like I said, if you get a chance to watch the videos on YouTube, the commission series is mind blowing.